Fine, dear students. So today we'll begin with the complete summary of this chapter, that morphology and anatomy of cockroach. So the background slide, you can see the external features of cockroach, then the digestive system of cockroach, circulatory system of cockroach, male and female reproductive system of cockroach. So these are the diagram oriented question that you might generally get in your the board examinations. So be geared up for this diagram oriented questions. So let us proceed with understanding this cockroach. So which kingdom, which phylum? So the biological classification of cockroach will be going through in today's class. See, cockroach scientific name is Periplaneta americanum. So Periplaneta means almost everywhere in the planet they are found. Americana, they have originated from America. Okay, so they are nocturnal omnivores. So these cockroaches are nocturnal omnivores. So they are found in the nighttime. They are they are active during nighttime, and they are omnivores. They can feed on almost anything. So they can feed on the plants or the animal products also. Sometimes I've told you that they even chew our skin. So you might have been bitten by the cockroach, but you do not know still the early in the morning, because most of the time they bite at your the keratinized skin. Okay, so you feel the redness and the soreness on the hand. So that is because of the cockroach which might have gnawed through your skin. Okay, so these cockroaches, they are omnivores. They live in damp places. You find them below the sink, wherever cool and shady and dark places you find these cockroaches. So they live in damp places which has some amount of moisture. So the biological classification of cockroaches, it belongs to the phylum Arthropoda, jointed legs. Okay, class Insecta. And their body is divisible into head, abdomen, the head, thorax, and abdomen. And they have three pairs of legs. Okay. So the genus is Periplaneta, species is Americanum. So their color, they are brown or black, bright yellow, red, and dark green colored cockroaches are also seen in the tropical regions. So you can notice them in the tropical regions also. Then the next point that you have to remember is the size of these cockroaches are 1/4 inch to 3 inches, that is 0.6 to 7.6 centimeter in size. So that is one aspect that you have to remember regarding the habitat and habit of cockroach. Okay. So if you look into the morphology of the cockroach, the adults are about 34 to 53 millimeter long. So body is covered by a very hard brown chitinous exoskeleton. So you can see this chitinous exoskeleton both at the ventral and dorsal surface. So you have this sclerites and the tergites, which are held by the arthrodial membrane. Okay, so body is covered by a hard brown chitinous exoskeleton. So in each segment, so you can see the segmented nature of these cockroaches. So in each segment, so you find the exoskeleton as hardened plates called sclerites. So what is sclerite is dorsal tergite. On the dorsal side, we call it as tergites, and on the ventral side, we call it as sternites. So the cockroach in each segment has exoskeleton which has hardened plates called as sclerites. So sclerites is a combination of dorsal sternites, dorsal tergites, and ventral sternites. So tergites and sternites together, we are calling them as sclerites. So the dorsal tergites, and ventral sternites together, we call them as sclerites. So they are joined to each other by a thin and flexible articular membrane or arthrodial membrane. So they are held joined by a thick and flexible articular membrane or arthrodial membrane. So now if you look into the body of it, the body has three regions: the head region, thorax, and abdomen. So in the thoracic region, you can find three pairs of legs. So first pair of leg is from the prothorax. So mesothorax gives rise to the second pair of legs, and metathorax, they give rise to the third pair of leg. And if you look into the legs, they are jointed structures. So arthropoda, jointed legs, you can notice that here. Okay. So the triangular head, this region is the triangular head. So it is formed by six fused segments. Six segments have fused to form the triangular head. So you find high degree of cephalization. So the sensory organs are concentrated in this head region along with the nervous system, central nervous system. So the triangular head is formed by the fusion of six segments. So six fused segments is going to give rise to the structure of head. It shows great mobility. The head shows great mobility in all the directions due to the flexible neck. So they can move their head in all the directions because of the flexible neck. So head bears a pair of thread-like antennae. So they have this thread-like filiform antennae, a pair of compound eyes with vomitidia. Okay, so they have this mosaic vision. We'll be coming across that. So head bears a pair of thread-like antennae, a pair of compound eyes, and biting and chewing type of mouth parts. So that mouth parts we'll be discussing about. So if you look into the morphology, this diagram shows the dorsal morphology. So they have this filiform, a pair of filiform antennae, compound eye. Then the hard surface where you like this, where you can see this eye-like structure. It is meant more to scare the predators. So it is the pronotum. Okay. Then you find the prothorax, mesothorax, and metathorax region. So prothoracic leg, mesothoracic leg, metathoracic leg, you can notice them. And you also find the wings. The wings, one of them, which is arising from the thoracic region, that is the tegmina, and the hind wing, it is arising from the metathorax. Okay, so the abdomen also, you can notice, they also have this anal cerci, and anal style is present only in case of male. So the body is divisible into head, thorax, and abdomen region. And you can notice that the flying wings, they are arising from these, the metathorax and the prothoracic region. So the two wings that you can notice here is tegmina and hind wing. So the head, the mouth parts in the head are, so they have a labrum, that is the upper lip, and lower lip, we call it as labium. They have two mandibles, okay, and they have a hypopharynx. Two maxillae is also seen. So the mouth parts of cockroaches, you find the labrum, the upper lip, the labium, which is the lower lip, and there is a two pairs of mandibles, a pair of mandible, you can call it as, with this structures which helps in grinding the food. So they also have tongue, which is also called as hypopharynx. Two maxillae, a pair of maxillae you can notice. So these are the mouth parts of cockroach. So you can see the ocellus, compound eye, filiform, antenna. Then you can also notice this maxilla, mandible, labrum, labium. So these are the mouth parts that are visible. So within the mouth, you find this hypopharynx, okay. So the mouth parts of cockroach, it is also called as trophi. So this diagram for NEET or for the five, sometimes they have asked for 5-mark question also, draw the trophi of cockroach or mouth parts of cockroach. So you should be aware about that. See, maxillae, they are also what you call it, a sensory in function. So they have this palps. Okay, So the future, the maxillae and mandibles, so they are going to form the jaws as the evolution take place. So they are going to end up into the jaw-like structures. So you just remember about that, the purpose of maxillae in cockroach. See, they are acting like pincers. They are used to hold and manipulate food. Okay, so the maxillae, they are used to hold and manipulate food so that it can be chewed or sliced by the mandibles. So they are acting like pincers. Okay, the maxillae have palps or segmented appendages that perform a sensory role, as I've already told you. So the maxillae also, they act as holding the food as pincers. They are used to hold and manipulate food so that it can be chewed or sliced by the mandibles. So that is the role of the maxillae. Okay, the maxillae have palps which are also sensory in function. Okay, so that is the thing that you have to remember. Then thoracic region, they have three parts: prothorax, mesothorax, and metathorax. So the head is connected to a thorax by a neck. A short extension of the prothorax itself acts as neck. So the head is connected to thorax by a neck, which is the short extension of the prothorax. Okay. Each thoracic segment bears a pair of walking legs. So I had already told you about prothoracic leg, mesothoracic leg, metathoracic leg. So in the ventral view, you can see it better. So each pair of each part or segment of this thorax has a pair of legs. So there are a pair of prothoracic legs, a pair of mesothoracic legs, a pair of metathoracic legs. Each thoracic segment bears a pair of walking legs. And style is found only in males. I'm talking about anal style, which is found only in case of males. So in the thoracic region, they have two pairs of wings, the fore wings and the hind wings. Okay, so the fore wings or mesothoracic or tegmina. So the fore wings is it is mesothoracic in origin, and they are also called as tegmina. Whereas the hind wings, they are metathoracic in origin. They are transparent, membranous, and they are used in the flight. So they have two pair of wings. Fore wings are two in number. Okay, and hind wings are in number. So the forewing, they arise from the mesothoracic. So forewings are also called as tegmina, and the hind wings are metathoracic in origin. They are transparent, membranous, and are used in flight. So in need, they might ask which wing is used in flight. So the answer is hind winged, which arises from the metathoracic region. They are used in flight. Okay, so the forewings are also called as tegmina. So they are opaque, dark, and leathery, and cover the hind wings when at rest. So that you have to remember regarding the pair of forewings and a pair of hind wings. Okay, so totally they are four in structure, or it might be two pairs of wings that you notice. So usually this forewing, so you can notice here it is already folded. So they cover the hind wings when at rest. So in one of them, we have kept it at rest. So the forewings are covering the hind wings when at rest. So they have a pair of forewings, which arises from the mesothoracic region, a pair of hind wings, which arises from the metathoracic region. So they are used in flight. Hind wings are used in flight. So the hind wings are transparent, membranous, and are used in flight. So what you see here, the closed wings, it's a pair of hind wings. Okay. Sorry, a pair of fore wings, or we also call it as tegmina. So what we see above on this cockroach is a pair of fore wings, or it is also called as tegmina. And the hind wings are hidden within this fore wings. So a pair of hind wings is there, which helps in flight. That is hidden within this forewing. So they have a pair of forewings, so or tegmina, which closes and covers the hind wings. Now, if you take the abdominal region, so it consists of 10 segments. Abdominal region has 10 segments. In females, the 7th boat-shaped, 8th and 9th, they are sterna, which form a brood or genital pouch. So it consists of 10 segments. The cockroach, the abdomen consists of 10 segments. In case of females, the 7th, which is boat-shaped, 7th segment, 8th and 9th, sterna, they are together going to form a brood genital pouch. So they are going to form a brood pouch, or you also call it as genital pouch in case of females. So what does this brood pouch made up of, the components of brood pouch? So you can notice here 7th, 8th and 9th. 7th is boat shaped segment, 8th and 9th, they are fused together at the sterna to form a brood pouch, or you also call it as genital pouch. Okay, so the you can notice here the genital pouch, so brood pouch or genital pouch. So the components of this brood pouch, it consists of female gonopore. So it consists of female gonopore, spermatheca pores, and collateral glands. So it consists of female gonopore, spermatheca pores, and collateral glands. In males, the genital pouch lies at the hind end of the abdomen. So it is bounded dorsally by 9th and 10th terga and ventrally by 9th sternum. So the genital pouch in male, it is present in the 9th and 10th terga, which is ventrally bound by the 9th sternum. Okay. So it contains, what are the components of this male genital pouch? It contains the dorsal. Excuse me. It contains the dorsal anus, ventral male genital pore or gonopore, and gonapophysis. So you notice that in case of males, the genital pouch lies at the hind end of segment, bounded dorsally by 9th and 10th terga and ventrally by 9th sternum. Okay, so it contains dorsal, the components of this the male genital pouch is dorsal anus, ventral male genital pore or gonopore and gonapophysis. So dorsal anus, ventral male genital pore, which we call it as gonopore and gonapophysis. So these are the components of the male genital pouch. In both the sexes, the 10th segment, that is both male and female cockroach, the 10th segment bears a pair of jointed anal sarcae. So both of them have a pair of jointed anal sarcae. So you can notice this anal sarcus is singular, anal sarcae is plural. And males, only males, they pair a pair of short thread-like anal styles. In both the sexes, the 10th segment bears a pair of jointed anal sarcae, that is both male and female, you can notice that. But male bears a pair of short thread-like anal styles. So you can notice this thread-like anal styles, which you find only in case of males. So males have style. I'm talking about the anal styles. So males bear a pair of short thread-like anal styles. So remember about that. So this is also one of the external way of differentiating the male and female cockroach, which we'll be discussing in the differences between male and female cockroach. Yes. So this is the slide where we are discussing the differences between male and female cockroach. So the male, it is larger in size. So the male cockroach is larger in size. Female cockroach is smaller in size. Okay, so when compared to male, the female cockroaches are smaller in size. So male cockroach is larger in size, female cockroach is smaller in size. So the wings extend, especially the forewings, they are going to extend beyond the tip of the abdomen. So the wings extend beyond the tips of the abdomen, whereas the wings do not extend beyond the tip of the abdomen in case of female. So the males have a narrow abdomen. You can notice it here. They have a narrow abdomen, whereas the females, they have a broad abdomen. So because they have to bear the utica, and so that is the reason they have a broad abdomen. So males have a narrow abdomen. Females have a broad abdomen. Anal styles are present only in males. Okay, so style is present only in males. So anal styles are absent in female. So the brood pouch is absent in case of males. They have male genital pouch, but they don't have a brood pouch. Okay, so whereas the brood pouch is present in females. So these are the differences between the male and female cockroach on external morphology. So for 2 marks, you should be prepared for such type of questions to differentiate between male and female cockroach. So now the next part that we'll be discussing is the digestive system of cockroach. Okay, so you are able to see the various parts of cockroach. I've always told you that when you are studying any organism digestive system, compare it with known part of it. Like human digestive system, if you compare it with that of cockroach digestive system, you find that many terminologies are same. So even in human beings, the tongue, we call it as hypopharynx. So from the tongue towards the buccal cavity, it leads into this esophagus. So esophagus leads into stomach, but in case of cockroach, the esophagus leads into crop, which is a reservoir for storage of food. And then they have gizzard. So gizzard has six blade-like structures, which helps in grinding the food. So they bring about the mechanical digestion of food in the gizzard. Then the entire alimentary canal, it is divided into 4 gut. From esophagus to the gizzard, so we consider it to be the foregut. In between the junction of foregut and midgut, you find finger-like protrusions, which we call it as hepatic cecae. Okay, so then the midgut or mesenteron, so they are divided into the different regions of it. So you find between the junction of midgut or mesenteron and the hindgut, you have numerous, nearly 100 to 150 yellow yeerish-like structures, which we call it as malphigian tubules. So malphigian tubules helps in removing the nitrogenous phase. And the hindgut has this ileum, the colon and rectum is found in the hindgut. Okay, so rectum is the reservoir of food. Whereas in our digestive system, we have an esophagus, stomach, and we have small intestine and large intestine. So small intestine, it is divided into 3 components, duodenum, jejunum, and ileum. Even here we use this term ileum. Then we have this large intestine or colon, which is having the ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, and then it finally, the undigested food is stored in the reservoir called as rectum, and finally thrown out through anus. That is in case of human beings, the digestive system. Here in case of cockroach, so you find that they don't have stomach, instead they have this crop and gizzard. They don't have intestine, small intestine, large intestine. Instead they have this mesenteron and hindgut. So where you find this in between the junction of foregut and midgut, you find finger-like protrusions called as hepatic cecae, and in between the midgut junction between the midgut and hindgut, you find 100 to 150 numerous filamentous hair-like structures called as malphigian tubules. They are excretory in function. They help in removing the nitrogenous waste. The cockroaches are also uricothelic animals. That is, they excrete the nitrogenous waste in the form of uric acid. In human beings, we are ureotelic animals. We excrete nitrogenous waste in the form of urea, and that is thrown out during the urination process. The nitrogenous waste from our bodies are thrown out. So excretory system is completely different. Digestive system is different. So we should not get confused between them. Okay. So alimentary canal of cockroach has 3 parts. That is foregut, midgut. Midgut is also called as mesenteron, and hindgut. Now, when we study the foregut, it is lined by cuticles. So foregut is lined by cuticles. So what are the components of the foregut? It includes the mouth, pharynx, esophagus, crop to store the food, and gizzard, which is proventriculus. So the gizzard helps in grinding the food. So it brings about the mechanical digestion of food. It has an outer layer of thick circular muscles and thick inner cuticle. So which together, so they have an outer layer of thick circular muscles and thick cuticle, inner cuticle, which forms six chitinous plates or teeth. So they help in grinding the food. So six chitinous plates are there. I told you in my days when we did this PU level, we had dissections. It was not banned. So the in the dissection, what we used to do was each of us had to cut the gizzard after exhibiting the digestive system. We were supposed to cut the gizzard and show the in and out. Inside out, we had to do and exhibit the six chitinous plates or teeth that they have. So it has an outer layer of thick circular muscles and thick inner cuticle. So outer layer of thick circular muscles and thick inner muscles, they form six chitinous plates or teeth, we call it as. They help in mechanical digestion of food. So still the gizzard, they are the foregut. The midgut or mesenteron, it is not lined by cuticle. So whereas the foregut was lined by cuticle, so the midgut, it is not lined by cuticle. 6 to 8 tubules or hepatic or gastric cecae. We also call it as hepatic or gastric cecae. They are seen at the junction of the foregut and midgut. So they secrete this hepatic cecae, hepatic cells. You can just recollect. In case of liver, we call the cells as hepatic cecae. So you hepatic cells. So here we have hepatic cecae, which are 6 to 8 tubules, which are seen at the junction of foregut and midgut. They secrete digestive juices. See, in case of liver, they secrete the bile juices, isn't it? So here the hepatic cecae, they secrete digestive juices. At the junction of midgut and hindgut, there are 100 to 150 yellow colored thin filamentous structures, which we call them as Malpighian tubules. So we call this yellow colored thin filamentous structures as Malpighian tubules. And I've already told you these Malpighian tubules are excretory in function. So where are they found? They are found in between the junction of midgut and hindgut. You notice this 100 to 150 filamentous, yellow colored thin filamentous structures, which we call it as Malpighian tubules. Malpighian tubules are excretory in function. So the hindgut, what you notice is it is broader than the midgut and the lined internally by cuticle. So the hindgut, it is broader than the midgut and it is lined internally by cuticle. So you notice this is the hindgut. Hindgut contains three parts of it: ileum, colon, and rectum. So hindgut contains ileum, colon, and rectum. So rectum opens out through the anus. So that is what is the components of hindgut. Now when we go to the next understanding of the circulatory system of cockroach, so the blood vascular system in cockroach, the circulatory system in cockroach is of open type because the heart pumps the blood into the open body spaces. They are not conducted through blood vessels, as in case of human beings, which is a closed type of circulatory system. Cockroach has an open type of circulatory system where the heart pumps blood into the body spaces, which is called as hemocele. So the blood vessels are poorly developed and open into body spaces, which we call it as hemocele. So the visceral organs are located in the hemocele and they are bathed in blood. So the blood is colorless. We call it as hemolymph, and the visceral organs are located in the body space or hemocele, and they are bathed in blood, hemolymph. Hemolymph is colorless plasma plus hemocytes. They have the cellular components, which we call it as hemocytes. So they have a colorless plasma and hemocytes. The circulatory system, the heart, it consists of an elongated tube lying along mid-dorsal line of thorax and abdomen. So heart consists of an elongated muscular tube lying along the mid-dorsal line of thoracic region. So this is the thoracic region and abdominal region. So it has funnel-shaped chambers. So the chambers of this heart, the muscular tube, it has funnel-shaped chambers with ostia on either side of this funnel-shaped chambers. So blood from sinuses enter heart through the ostia. So they have a pair of ostia on either side. So the funnel-shaped chambers has a pair of with ostia on either side. So blood from the sinuses, they enter heart through ostia and is pumped anteriorly to sinuses again. So the blood is pumped anteriorly to sinuses again. So that is what is the circulation of blood. So the blood is going to enter through the ostia from the sinuses. The blood enter through the ostia into the funnel-shaped chambers. So blood from this so ostia, it enters through ostia into the funnel-shaped chambers, and they are again pumped through the anteriorly to sinuses again. The next thing that we have to study under the cockroaches, respiratory system of cockroach. Now, if you look into the respiratory system of cockroach, it consists of a network of trachea. So in human beings, what do we notice for respiratory system? We have a pair of nostrils, which leads into nasal cavity, then pharynx. So different parts of pharynx are there, nasopharynx, oropharynx, laryngopharynx. So all those different regions of pharynx, it passes through the nasal cavity, and then it leads into a tube, which we call it as trachea. Trachea has C-shaped cartilages, which prevents it from collapsing. So that is in case of human beings. And this trachea branches into left and right bronchi, and they enter into the lungs. So this bronchi further branches to form bronchioles. And each bronchiole at the end, they end up with this saccular structure, or alveoli, we call it as ear sacs, which we call it as alveoli. And you know that alveoli is lined by this squamous epithelium, and they are surrounded by the capillaries, which are also lined by squamous epithelium, simple squamous epithelium, and they help in diffusion of, they provide the diffusion surface. Okay, so that we already know. This is in case of human beings, but the respiratory system in cockroach, which belongs to arthropoda, it consists of a network of trachea. You can't notice here lungs and other things, but it consists of network of trachea that open through 10 pairs of small holes called spiracles. So it consists of network of trachea, which opens through 10 pairs of small holes called spiracles. So present on the lateral side of the body. So they don't have any nostrils. Rather, they have the spiracles, which opens through the lateral side of the body on both the ends. So the thin branches of tracheal tube. So you can notice here this thin branches of tracheal tube. So this is completely, it is a large trachea. So the thin branches of tracheal tubes, which the branched ones, we call it as tracheoles. So they carry oxygen from the atmosphere. Here implies here, they carry the oxygen from the atmosphere to all parts of the body. So the opening of spiracles is regulated by sphincters. So gaseous exchange takes place at the tracheoles by diffusion. So gaseous exchange takes place at the tracheoles by diffusion. So if you look into this tracheal respiratory system, you need not have to draw this diagram for just for the understanding of what we are talking about. So the atmospheric air enters through the spiracle located at the lateral ends of the cockroach. So the spiracle, the atmospheric air enters into the large trachea. The tracheas are branched to form the tracheoles, and the tracheoles are connected to carry oxygen to all parts of the body. So you can notice that the tracheoles are carrying the oxygen to all parts of the body. The opening of the spiracle is controlled by sphincter. So gaseous exchange takes place by diffusion. Even in us, even though we have a respiratory system, we have lungs and everything. So ultimately the gaseous exchange takes place between the capillary and alveoli, between the blood and the alveoli, and it is by diffusion. Okay, so even though we have special organs and organ system, finally the exchange of respiratory gases is by diffusion. So even here in cockroach, you notice that gaseous exchange takes place at the tracheoles by diffusion. The next that we have to discuss about is the excretory system in cockroach. Okay, so the excretory system in cockroach, I've already told you, they are uricotelic animals. What do you mean by uricotelic animals? So they are going to secrete the nitrogenous waste in the form of uric acid. Okay, the excretory organ is Malpighian tubules. See, along with insects, birds secrete nitrogenous waste in the form of uric acid. So when we come to the chapter of excretory system in man, we'll again discuss about that. Man is a ureotelic animal because he secretes the nitrogenous waste in the form of urea. So the cockroach is uricotelic because they secrete the nitrogenous waste in the form of uric acid. And excretory organ of cockroach is Malpighian tubules. Each Malpighian tubule, it is lined by glandular and ciliated cells. So you find in between the junction of midgut and hindgut, 100 to 150 filamentous, yellow filamentous tubules, which are yellow filamentous hair-like structures, which we call it as Malpighian tubules. So each tubule, Malpighian tubule, is lined by glandular and ciliated cells. So they absorb the nitrogenous waste and they convert them into uric acid. And it is excreted through the hindgut. It is excreted out through the hindgut. So the fat body, nephrocytes, and uricose glands also help in excretion. So the fat body, the nephrocytes, and uricose glands also help in excretion. So this is what you have to remember in case of cockroach. Whereas in man, if you remember it, we are ureotelic animals. Our excretory organ is a pair of kidneys. So kidneys would be having the structural and functional unit, which we call it as nephron. So nephron is made up of the renal corpuscle, which consists of Bowman's capsule and glomerulus, and the tubules. So the tubules, renal tubules, which consists of the distal convoluted tubule, Henle's loop, proximal convoluted tubule, Henle's loop, distal convoluted tubule, and collecting tubule. So all those are the renal tubule part of it. So renal corpuscle and renal tubule. So that is what you notice in case of human beings. But in case of cockroach, it is very simple type of excretory organ that they have, Malpighian tubules. So the Malpighian tubule is lined by glandular and ciliated cells. They absorb nitrogenous waste and they convert them into uric acid. And it is excreted through the hindgut. Finally, it is thrown out through the anus. Okay, so they do not have a separate urinary system with urinary bladder and other things what we notice in human beings. That is not here. Notice here, the nitrogenous waste is also thrown out through the hindgut anus. So the fat body, nephrocytes, and uricose gland also help in excretion. So that you have to remember about. So nervous system in case of cockroach is very primitive type. In human beings, our nervous system consists of a central nervous system, which is made up of brain and spinal cord. The peripheral nervous system, which has the sensory nerves, motor nerves, or mixed nerves. And we have this, the other thing that is autonomous nervous system, the sympathetic and parasympathetic. So all those are in case of human beings. What about the nervous system of cockroach? It is of primitive type. They have this segmentally arranged ganglia, which are joined by a pair of this ventral, so longitudinal connectives on the ventral side. So they are joined by longitudinal connectives on the ventral side. So three ganglia lie in the thoracic region and six ganglia. So ganglion are the protrusions that you can notice here, the thickened structures. So three ganglion lies in the thoracic region, and six ganglion lies in the abdominal region. The head holds only a bit of this nervous system. Remaining part is situated along the ventral part. Okay, so if the head of cockroach is cut off, so it can remain alive even for many weeks, because most of the nervous system lies in the thoracic and abdominal ganglion. So the head holds only a bit of nervous system. So the supraesophageal ganglion, or the brain, which supplies nerves to antenna and compound eye, so it is found in the head region. The supraesophageal ganglion, which supplies nerves, which connects nerves to the antenna and compound eye, they lie in the head region. So that is the thing that you have to remember. So very little of brain lies in the, very little of the nervous system lies in the head region. So even if the head is decapitated, the cockroach can remain alive for longer duration of time. But the supraesophageal ganglion, or the brain, which is located in the head region, they connect nerves to the antenna and compound eyes. So the sense organs, antenna, eye, maxillary palps, labial palps. So I told you they are sensory in maxillae, they are sensory, the palps are sensory in function. So the antennae, eyes, maxillary palps, labial palps, anal cerci, they are all the sense organs. Sensory receptors of antennae, they monitor the environment. So they are going to be like the environment, the external part of the environment is monitored by this filiform antennae. Okay, sensory receptors on this filiform antennae, they monitor the environment. So each compound eye, they consists of, if you look into this compound eye, they consists of 2000 hexagonal ommatidium. So each compound eye consists of 2000 hexagonal. You can notice here the hexagonal ommatidium. So the individual units, we call it as ommatidia. So they have a compound eye. Using these ommatidia, a cockroach can receive several images. See the mosaic vision, you can notice here, a cockroach can receive several images of an object. This is called mosaic vision. So mosaic vision, it has more sensitivity towards this images, but less resolution. The resolution is less, but more sensitivity is there. So that is the advantage of having this compound eye. So they each, using this ommatidia, a cockroach can receive several images of an object. So which is called as mosaic vision. It has more sensitivity, but less resolution. And it is common during nighttime, where it has more sensitivity, but less resolution being noticed during nighttime. And thus the cockroaches are having a nocturnal vision. So it is having more of, the vision is more of adapted for night type of vision. So nocturnal vision you can notice in cockroach. Now the male reproductive system of cockroach. So even in any reproductive system of higher animals, you notice a pair of testes, and they would be having vas deferens. So within the testes, what do you notice? So you find the Sertoli cells, Leydig cells, you find the seminal vesicles. So where the purpose of the testes is to produce the sperm cells. Okay, there is spermogenesis taking place. So now even in case of the male reproductive system of cockroach, they have to produce the sperm. So the what are the components of a male reproductive system? It consists of a pair of testes similar to higher animals. They have seminal vesicles. You can notice this finger-like things, that is the seminal vesicles. They have accessory glands, okay, and external genitalia. So they have accessory glands and external genitalia. So the male reproductive system of cockroach consists of a pair of testes, seminal vesicles here, almost a mushroom-like structure you can see. The seminal vesicles here and accessory glands and external genitalia. So that is external genital organ part of it. That is the external genitalia, the phallomas, represent the genitalia, external genitalia. So in this diagram, you can notice that they have a pair of testes. So you can notice the seminal vesicles. There is vas deferens. So the sperms produced in the pair of testes is carried through the vas deferens, and they enter into the seminal vesicles and ejaculatory duct, and through the phallomeres they are liberated. Okay, so they have a pair of testes, seminal vesicles, accessory glands, external genitalia. So this is a simple diagram that you have to remember about. And only male cockroach has this style, so the caudal style, or we also call it as anal style. So you have the left phallomere, ventral phallomere, right phallomere, and you also have the pseudo penis like structure. Okay, then titillator are there. So these are all the different parts of a male reproductive system. So now when we go into the description part of it, so where does this testis lie? So they lie laterally in the fourth and sixth abdominal segments. From fourth to sixth abdominal segments, you can notice this testis. Each testis, it has a thin vas deferens. It leads into vas deferens, thin vas deferens, and vas deferens opens into seminal vesicles. From the seminal vesicles, it is going to the sperms develop. They are all going to be passed through this ejaculatory duct, and ejaculatory duct opens out through this male gonophore. That is the opening, we call it as male gonophore. So the seminal vesicles are regions where they store the sperms, and sperms are glued together. They are made to stick together in the seminal vesicles. The sperms are made to stick together to form bundles called as spermatophores. So these spermatophores are released. They are not released as individual sperms. So they form bundles called as spermatophores. So these spermatophores are released during the copulation or sexual mating process. Okay, so they have shown the cockroach mating process also. So wherein they are going to, the males are going to release the sperms as spermatophores. Okay, so they are discharged during copulation. So the accessory gland includes a mushroom gland in sixth and seventh abdominal so region. You find this mushroom type of gland, which we call it as phallic gland. So the secretions nourish the sperms. So the external genitalia, that is male gonapophysis or phallomeres, we call it as. You notice this left phallomeres, ventral phallomere, right phallomeres. So that is the external genitalia. So the chitinous asymmetrical structures surrounding the male gonophore. So there are chitinous asymmetrical structures which surround the male gonophores. So remember about that. That is the external genitalia. The female reproductive system of cockroach. So it is much more simpler diagram. Even in case of higher animals, the female reproductive system, they consist of a pair of ovaries. Then you have the oviduct or fallopian tubules, then ampulla and other things. In case of human female reproductive system, so then it leads into the uterus. So here it is much more simpler in arthropoda. They have a pair of ovaries, oviducts are there. So the oviducts connect to a common oviduct, which we also call it as vagina. Common oviduct is the vagina. They have the collateral glands. Genital chamber is there. Instead of the uterus, they have here the genital chamber. So they have the vestibulum structure and gonapophysis. So the genital chamber, gonapophysis, vestibulum, we call it as genital pouch, the collateral glands. So I told you the seventh, eighth and ninth segments, the seventh segment, which is boat shaped, eighth and ninth segments, they are going to form the genital pouch or brood pouch. So the components of brood pouch, we had discussed about gonapophysis, gonopore, then the collateral glands. Okay, so all those you can notice it here. So they also have the spermatheca located here. So This is the components of female reproductive system. So the female reproductive system of cockroach consists of two large ovaries, oviducts, spermatheca, genital chamber, collateral glands. So these are the components of the female reproductive system. So the ovary lies laterally in the from the second to sixth abdominal segment. You notice this ovary. Each ovary is formed of 8 ovarian tubules. Okay, so you can notice this 8 ovarian tubules. So each ovary is made up of 8 ovarian tubules. Here you find 5 of them. Backside of it, you find the remaining 3. So the 8 of them are their ovarian tubules. Together, they form the ovary. Each ovary is formed of 8 ovarian tubules, or we also call it as ovarioles. So they contain a chain of developing ova. So the oviducts of each ovary, they are going to unite. Okay. So the oviduct of each ovary unite into a common median oviduct. So the common oviduct, which we call it also as vagina, and this opens into the genital chamber. Okay. So the common oviduct opens into the vaginal chamber. So a pair of spermatheca, can you notice the small bulbous like structure? A pair of spermatheca is present in the sixth abdominal segment, which opens into the genital chamber. So a pair of spermatheca opens into the genital chamber. So the sperms are transferred through spermatophores. They're fertilized eggs. So the sperms that have been received are transferred through the spermatophores. So their fertilized eggs are encased utike. So the fertilized eggs are present within this encased utike. So utike, it is not a single egg, it has many of them. Utike is a dark reddish to blackish brown capsule, which is 8 millimeter long. So females lay 9 to 10 utike. So they can lay around 9 to 10 utike. Each contain 14 to 16 eggs. So the utike contains 14 to 16 eggs. So when they are going to the eggs, when they are going to open up, they release 14 to 16 young ones are formed. So each utike, so sperms are transferred through spermatophores. Their fertilized eggs are encased by utike. Utike is a dark reddish to brownish, blackish brown capsule, which is 8 millimeter long. Females lay 9 to 10 utike. Each utike contains 14 to 16 eggs. The development of Periplaneta americana is pauro-metabolous, that is development which passes through nymphal stage. So from the utike, the nymphs arise. So the nymphs looks like adults. They molt. So this nymphs look like adults. Okay, they molt 13 times to reach the adult form. So the ecdysis or molting takes for 13 times before they form the adult. So they are shedding their skin. So they are molting 13 times, the nymphs, 13 times they undergo molting to form the adult form. The next to last nymphal stage, they have wing pads. Just before they form the adults, the next to last nymphal stage, that is penultimate stage, you can notice in the nymphs, wing pads are there. Only adult cockroaches have wings. That also you should remember, only the adult cockroaches are having wings. So the utike lays nearly 14 to 16 nymphs are formed, and this nymphs undergo 13 times they undergo molting or ecdysis, where they shed their skin. As they grow, they shed their skin. Sometimes you find the cockroaches white in color, you can just understand they have freshly undergone ecdysis or molting. So they undergo 13 molting or ecdysis before they achieve the adult stage. Okay, and the development of cockroach Periplaneta americana is pauro metabolous because they pass through a nymphal stage. Okay, the penultimate nymphal stage, it has wing pads. So next to the last nymphal stage, the nymph has wing pads. So wings are found only in the adult cockroaches. Okay, so these are the things that you have to remember. So the economic importance of cockroach. They are pests, so they are not important for us in any way. They are more of a nuisance. Okay, so many times you might be wondering, even after so much of continued use of medicines, HIT and other things, you might be spraying them, but you find the cockroach goes on surviving because of their WU-TK, which contains 14 to 16 eggs. So they are going to produce themselves in large number. If you are able to destroy this WU-TK, maybe you might be able to eradicate the word. So many companies, they invest crores of rupees because they know that cockroaches cannot be completely eradicated. They have resistance they develop through, and also their each cockroach, each WU-TK that they have, they give rise to 16 to 14 nymphs, 14 to 16 nymphs, which might survive. A few of them might survive. So they are going to multiply in larger numbers. Okay, so that is the reason that most of the companies, they have this sprays which kills the adults but not the the young ones or the egg part of it, WU-TK part of it. So the cockroaches are more of a nuisance because they destroy food and they contaminate the food with their smelly excreta. So they almost feed through anything. See, you can see that they are feeding through the beer. They are feeding the bread part of it. Such, they bring about contamination. They spread the virus. If we consume such food consumed by the cockroaches, they are surely going to cause. They also transmit diseases. The cockroaches like cholera, typhoid, tuberculosis can be transmitted. They don't cause it. They might be a vector. So they can transmit these diseases, cholera, typhoid, tuberculosis. Okay, so because most of them live in the ditches and sanitary pits, so you should be very careful of the cockroaches. And so this is about the economic importance, which is more of harm, so it is more of a pest to us. So gastroenteritis is caused by these cockroaches, so you should be remembering this cockroach. So it is believed that cockroach and mosquitoes can survive even if there is a nuclear warfare. All the other organisms might be killed, but cockroaches and mosquitoes, they are believed to survive because of their adaptability and their resistance that they develop within a short duration of time. So they are believed, so especially the insects like mosquitoes and cockroach, they can survive even the nuclear holocaust. That is what there is a general belief with. So that completes our discussion on this cockroach topic. So if you are having any doubts, you can just get it clarified.